Stanford University.
Good evening. Welcome, everyone, to Honoring the Ghosts, a project to explore the relationships between war, trauma, the arts, and healing. I'm Audrey Schaefer. I'm an anesthesiologist at the Palo Alto VA Hospital, and I'm also the director of Medicine in the Muse, which is a program at the Stanford Center for Biomedical Ethics. I would particularly like to extend a welcome to all those here who serve or have served in the military, to their families and friends, and to those who volunteer and work for veterans. So thank you for coming. I can't see where you are, but welcome. I would also like to welcome our Italic undergraduate students who have done some work with our dance troupe, so welcome to them as well. Excellent. Honoring the Ghosts is actually a two-part series, and the first part occurred last fall at the new Anderson Collection at Stanford. This magnificent museum just opened in September, I believe, and we held an event there. So I would like to thank the staff and the leadership of the Anderson Collection for collaborating with us on this project. And I would encourage anyone who has not been to this wonderful museum to go check out the 20th century art there. I would also like to extend a heartfelt sense of gratitude towards the Stanford Arts Institute, whose generous and enthusiastic support for this project also extends to the mission of the Stanford Medicine the Muse program. I had the opportunity yesterday to see Roman Baca and the Exit 12 dance troupe in an outreach performance at the Menlo Park VA. I would say I was struck by the transcendent and transformational qualities of art, but I was also deeply struck by how personal art is. Art is amazing in its ability to connect people, but it is also bone deep. It's within us, within each of us. And I think that tonight we will see how art transcends time, transcends cultures, helps us form as a community within this theater, but also honors the individual, very human nature of each and every one of us. So now, I would like to welcome to the podium the person who conceived, developed, and organized this entire Honoring the Ghost event. This person is the Assistant Director of the Medicine the Muse program. Please join me in welcoming the amazing Jacqueline Genovese.
Well, first off, I want you all to congratulate yourselves for finding Dinklespiel and finding a parking spot. So pat yourselves on the back. This is a tough campus. Before I start with the introductions, I just want to ask everyone to please make sure your cell phones are turned off and there's no recording during the performance. We have a photographer and a professional videographer, and we'll be posting these online after the performance. So thank you. I just wanted to, by way of introduction for both Exit 12 and Professor Nemerov, just tell you a little story. The spark for this program happened 4 years ago on a really hot summer evening in Kentucky. I was presenting my thesis work on post-traumatic story disorder at a conference for veterans, and on the program was Exit 12 Dance Company, ballet company, and I was trying to get a group of young Marine veterans to come with me to the performance, and they're like, it's ballet, no, we don't think so. And I said, well, Roman is a Marine, so how bad could it be, right? So the theater was outside, it was hot, there were mosquitoes, we were sweating, they were giving me dirty looks. Well, then the performance started and we were just transported. And so I am so grateful to Stanford for giving all of us in the West Coast their very first glimpse of Exit 12. And they're just, I don't want to say too much, they're just phenomenal. And speaking of phenomenal, Professor Alexander Nemerov, a lot of you already know him, the students, he was voted like one of the top 10 faculty, but I didn't know him. What I knew about him was this book that I saw in the library when I was doing research for the proposal. And it's called Wartime Kiss, Visions of the Moment in the 1940s. And it turns out that Professor Nemerov has a personal and professional interest. And I just shot him off an email and I was like, oh my gosh, we're doing this program, your research is right in line, and it would be so wonderful if you could participate. And he's just been so generous with his time and impressive with his mentoring of students. Audrey mentioned the gallery talk we had in November, and Alex called me and he said, is it okay if one of my doctoral students gives that talk? And I was like, absolutely. I can see why he was voted, you know, one of the top 10 professors. So the way we're going to do this, this serves as the introduction, and Professor Nemerov will speak, and then we'll go right into the performance. I wanted to start with Professor Nemerov because today happens to be the 150th anniversary of Abraham Lincoln's last public speech before he went to Ford's Theater. And so I thought it was fitting, and his speech was about reconciliation during Reconstruction. So I thought it was fitting to begin the evening with poetry by a Civil War veteran. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Professor Alexander Nemerov.
Thank you, Jackie, and thank you all for being here. It's an honor to be here. Dying soldiers, the dead Lincoln, even just the ordinary moments of daily life during the Civil War, moments that each pass, that each die gone before we know it, Walt Whitman wanted to commemorate all of these. Commemorations, however, presented a problem. It meant turning life to stone, to ice, to crystal. No action that swaggers on the eye, no life, however rich and full of blood, but that it must be made into the coldness of tribute. All those Civil War monuments planned even as the war went on, froze the fallen hero in a pose of stalwart immobility that repeated the stillness of his death. Whitman wrote in his memoranda during the war of 1876 that already the war's events have lost their direct personal impression in the living heat and excitement of their own time and are being marshaled for casting or getting ready to be cast into the cold and bloodless electrotype plates of history. History on the page, history as sculpture, they amount to the same thing. The printed page is itself a sculpture, a low relief, solemn inscription set in stone. What visible material monument can ever fittingly commemorate the spot, Whitman asks, but he proceeds with his own monument, the poems of drum taps and the diary entries of that book, Memoranda During the War. And that's what I want to talk about tonight, how he invests each moment with a glitter, a flutter of life. And how he does it through a corona or aureole of light, of glowing activity. He makes flower above his dead and dying people and moments. No moment is so still that it cannot be fitted for one of these sparkling wreaths or crowns. Lincoln's death Whitman writes, purging, illuminating all, throws round his form, his head, an aureole that will remain and will grow brighter through time. The lilac blossoms. Copious I break, says Whitman. I break the sprigs from the bushes. With loaded arms I come, pouring for you, and the coffins, all of you, O death. And the thrush music in the same poem, just as copious sounding, pouring in multiple notes. I hear your notes, I hear your call is another such effusion, as are the pale green leaves of the trees prolific, and even the dwellings so dense, the infinite separate houses expanding ever outward in Lincoln's country, themselves a kind of blooming flower or chattering song blooming around and about the dead president. Kisses also bloom and glow. Erastus Haskell's dying kiss to Whitman at the Armory Square Hospital, the many kisses between Whitman and the Confederate soldier William S. Prentice, the kiss to Oscar F. Wilbur of the 154th New York, which Wilbur, Whitman says, returned fourfold. These, like Caspar Goodwood's to Isabel Archer in Henry James's Portrait of a Lady, spread and spread again and stayed, amounting in the case of these dying soldiers to a breath, an intensified breath that outlives life, the air from one pair of gunshot lungs passing as though for safekeeping into the mouth of one still healthy and strong. Outside, the immobility of Washington's architecture itself, Whitman likewise took care to animate, to keep from freezing, as in his description of the patent office on the night of October 20th, 1863, when a voluptuous half moon, slightly golden, delicately lights the stone facade and round about, the sky, the planets, the constellations, all so bright, so calm, so expressively silent, seem to circulate, to circumambiate, as Whitman liked to say, around the building they seem all but designed to illuminate. And at the White House, too, on another moonlit evening, February 24th, 1863, Whitman activates the frozen building, playing upon it the tender and soft moonlight, he writes, and then, for good measure, the brilliant and extra plentiful clusters of gas, and still more around and upon it, the forms of the trees, leafless, silent in trunk and myriad angles of branches under the stars and sky, so that the building's stillness cannot be tolerated without around it a soft and copious floral crown of shadow and star must be made to play. In the poetry, there are some great examples of these radiant effects. One is the poem called Cavalry Crossing a Ford, a short poem in which a passing scene, a passing moment, is given a kinesthetic sparkle, and I'll read that poem to you now. Cavalry crossing a ford, a line in long array where they wind betwixt green islands, they take a serpentine course, their arms flash in the sun, hark to the musical clank, behold the silvery river, as in it the splashing horses loitering stop to drink. Behold the brown-faced men, each group, each person a picture, the negligent rest on the saddles, some emerge on the opposite bank, others are just entering the ford, while scarlet and blue and snowy white, the guidon flags flutter gaily in the wind. So the arms flashing in the sun, the silvery river and splashing horses, these impart a glitter and almost gratuitous array of flash points, as though if Whitman were a painter nearing a completion of a canvas, a landscape, say, he would compulsively administer dabs of white paint across that canvas, the better as a finishing touch to make each leaf on each tree shine with the reflected sun. The guidon flags, too, that flutter gaily in the wind are a sign there at the end of the poem that for Whitman a pennant must fly from each scene he describes, all frozen moments to avoid becoming cold and bloodless electrotype plates of history must whip in the wind. The play of light, the corona of glitter, is still more compulsive in another short poem from Drum Taps called Bivouac on a Mountainside, which I'll read to you now. Bivouac on a Mountainside. I see before me now a traveling army halting below a fertile valley spread with barns and the orchards of summer. Behind, the terraced sides of a mountain, abrupt, in places rising high, broken with rocks, with clinging cedars, with tall shapes dingily seen, the numerous campfires scattered near and far, some away up on the mountain, the shadowy forms of men and horses looming large-sized, flickering, and over all, the sky far, far out of reach, studded, breaking out the eternal stars. The poem deals with a halt, a cessation of movement, a traveling army halting, the world threatening to become still, but then around and above that, Whitman scatters the campfires and the stars, so that here too, as in cavalry crossing a ford, we get sparkles from the wheel. To cite the title of the great poem, not a war poem, that's maybe Whitman's most eloquent statement of this wish, this penchant to throw sparks from the stationary scene, as he describes the withered old knife grinder at the side of the street, putting the knife to the spinning stone so that forth issue then in copious golden jets, sparkles from the wheel. So that the poet, much moved, notes again the low, hoarse purr of the whirling stone, the light pressed blade diffusing, dropping, sideways darting in tiny showers of gold, sparkles from the wheel. Poetry itself then must be for Whitman like the knife grinder's activity. The poet too must speak in that low hoarse purr, he too sitting down and with measured tread, must with his pen, his light pressed pen, moving, scribbling furiously, diffusing, dropping, sideways darting, distribute a copious excess of radiant effects, grinding out the campfires, the stars, the flashing sabers and fluttering flags, that must veritably stream and proliferate from each of his verses if he is to give the effect, as he claimed, of never producing something finished or fixed. And maybe even it's the language, each one of the words, their sound, forgetting their meaning, their sound and their rushing continuity, their ceaseless flow, that's meant to be such a glittering effusion in Whitman's poetry, as though the reading, or better, the speaking, of a Whitman poem were to experience, to enact the corona of flying sparks. So take the case of one of the most beautiful of the Civil War poems, the one called Vigil Strange I Kept on the Field One Night, with its almost breathless generation of bursting effects, each replacing, each trying to cancel out the singular fact of death. And I'll read that poem to you now. Vigil strange I kept on the field one night. Vigil strange I kept on the field one night when you, my son, my comrade, dropped at my side that day. One look I but gave, which your dear eyes returned with a look I shall never forget. One touch of your hand to mine, oh boy, reached up as you lay on the ground. Then onward I sped in the battle, the even contested battle, till late in the night, relieved to the place at last, again I made my way, found you in death so cold, dear comrade, found your body son of responding kisses, never again on earth responding, bared your face in the starlight, curious the scene, cool blew the moderate night wind, long there and then in vigil I stood, dimly around me, the battlefield spreading, vigil wondrous and vigil sweet, there in the fragrant silent night, but not a tear fell, not even a long-drawn sigh. Long, long I gazed, then on the earth, partially reclining, sat by your side, leaning my chin in my hands, passing sweet hours, immortal and mystic hours with you, dearest comrade, not a tear, not a word, vigil of silence, love and death, Vigil for you, my son and my soldier, as onward silently stars aloft, eastward new ones upward stole. Vigil final for you, brave boy, I could not save you. Swift was your death, I faithfully loved you and cared for you living. I think we shall surely meet again, till at latest lingering of the night, indeed, just as the dawn appeared, my comrade I wrapped in his blanket, enveloped well his form, folded the blanket well, tucking it carefully overhead and carefully under feet, and there and then, and bathed by the rising sun, my son in his grave, in his rude dug grave, I deposited, ending my vigil strange, with that vigil of night and battlefield dim, vigil for boy of responding kisses, never again on earth responding, vigil for comrade swiftly slain, vigil I never forget, how as day brightened, I rose from the chill ground and folded my soldier well in his blanket and buried him where he fell. There are the stars, the fragrant night, and the moonlit battlefield spreading out, the sweet hours, the mystic hours, the resurrecting rising sun, the panoply of immortality, and it's a measure of Whitman's attachment to these effects, his exacting use of them that his 20th century emulators among battlefield writers, people like Ernie Pyle or James Jones with their erotic, manly clasps of living and dead hands at Monte Cassino and Guadalcanal, do not bother with, do not even think of these firmaments of eternal softness. But even beyond this, as I say, there's this simple sound of Whitman's words, their rushing profusion too, that amounts to a limitless poured chant like the thrush in When Lilacs Last in the Dooryard Bloomed, that seems to come from the bushes themselves, from the ground of vegetal effusion in which leaf and voice are indistinguishable, that grows up and protectively around the dead. Yet Whitman's Civil War poetry would not be so moving if it did not acknowledge that this efflorescence always appears around a deathly stasis, a blankness, an emptiness that it cannot change. When the fateful letter arrives in the poem called Come Up From the Fields, Father, we immediately read of the trees, the leaves fluttering in the moderate wind, the apples ripe in the orchards, the grapes on the trellised vines, the buckwheat and the bees lately buzzing all at that Ohio homestead, but all this is nothing we know because like the letter writer's italicized words that the son, Pete, will soon be better, these organic bursts of leaf and apple and grape can never make the son who is actually dead better. And so Vigil Strange makes the same thing clear. My comrade, I wrapped in his blanket, enveloped well his form, folded the blanket well, tucking it carefully overhead and carefully under feet to be in his rude dug grave deposited. The strange allusions to letter writing of forms folded, enveloped, and deposited suggest that all commemorative writing, all memoranda, no matter how much a direct personal impression, cannot help but repeat the finality of the death it tries to garland in sparkling immortality. Each moment, truly, not just the moment of a comrade's death, but even a charming scene like that in Cavalry Crossing a Ford must be by being written down, buried where it fell. And another measure of this sad but powerful realization in Whitman's Civil War writing is that the scene of death is sometimes hidden, gone, unknowable. The poet may strew it with lovely effects, but the place, the moment itself, cannot be known. The dying soldier, Whitman writes, crawls aside to some bush clump or ferny tuft on receiving his death shot, and there dies on that secluded spot, unburied and unknown. At Ford's Theater on the night of April 14, 1865, the assassination of Abraham Lincoln took place, Whitman writes, during a pause, a hush, a moment when a scene had finished and the stage was clear, though around this momentous event, circling around it, Whitman writes, and stretching into the future for many a century, in the politics, history, and art of the new world, was many a reaction. And though on the immediate night in question, there followed the single gunshot, a deluge of panicked sound and action, a mixture of horror, noises, uncertainty, of people bursting through chairs and railings like some horrible carnival, he says. The audience rushing on the stage, several hundred soldiers appearing suddenly in the theater, inflamed with fury, while outside still more gathered crowds of people filled with frenzy while all this happened, and while Whitman himself bestows his corona of splendor, the death shot took place in that hush, darkness, that is itself an unknown place, a bush clump, a ferny tuft. And maybe, in fact, there's a little bit more to this. Maybe the glowing effects in Whitman's poetry spring up not as emanations of ongoing budding life itself, not exactly, but more in the way of the title of tonight's presentation, more in the way of shades, spirits, ghosts, supernatural emanations. Other writers from the time were just as dissatisfied as Whitman with the thing itself, the scene, the person described in all its architectural frozenness, and were consequently always looking for ways that these persons or things exuded a penumbra, a something spectral, a something extra beyond their given hard, sharp outlines. Alexander Gardner, the photographer, in the text to his 1866 photographic sketchbook of the war, wrote of the wind sweeping across the battlefield and waving the hair of the dead, a macabre detail that Stephen Crane would capitalize on in his own description many years later in The Red Badge of Courage of a dead man's fluttering beard. Noah Brooks, the California newspaper correspondent and wartime friend of Lincoln, described Lincoln's own disturbing awareness as he laid down to rest in the White House of his face appearing in reflection not once but twice in a nearby swinging mirror, the second face appearing, Lincoln said, a little paler, five shades paler than the first, a ghost, he called it. And so a doubleness he and his wife both took for an unwelcome premonition. And Brooks, the journalist, too, describes soldiers camping in dusty Virginia woods, several thousand troops chattering and setting up camp so that their noise seems strangely to emanate disembodied in the air all around them. An undulating volume of sound, he said, like the noise of birds seeking their roosts at night. And Brooks mentions as well that at the Grand Victory Parade down Pennsylvania Avenue at the end of the war, it seemed that another spectral army of the dead marched alongside the glittering columns. Another host, he writes, spectral and shadowy, moving with and over them with silent tread in the viewless air. Two armies, one living and one dead. All these were indications that the extra effect, the Whitmanian way that a given place or thing emits radiances and glows and after emanations of itself, was not only to be seen as a sign of life. When Whitman describes the play of light and shadow on the White House facade on that night of February 24, 1863, he talks of the moonlight. He says, making peculiar, faint, languishing shades on that facade, a very ghostly sounding set of terms, evoking, in fact, the faintness and the languidness and the soon-to-be deadness of the soldiers to whom he ministered. And when the night before, on February 23rd, he describes the wounded soldiers in the hospital, their beds arranged amid the high and ponderous glass cases there, containing various inventions, curiosities, and gifts in a building that was then the patent office. And when he describes the wounded as themselves cases, cases like these glass cases, shuttling between the two types of case, the wounded man and the patented glass-closed invention, as in the following two successive sentences, I go sometimes at night to soothe and relieve particular cases, Two of the immense apartments are filled with high and ponderous glass cases. When he describes all this, when he describes further the wounded with their glassy eye amid these glassy cases, we're to understand this relay, this back and forth between the wounded and the invented, the two kinds of cases, as another of Whitman's excessive effects, where the soldiers appear apparitionally as if truly reflected in the mirroring furniture around them, the dying man with his glassy eye, able then even to see the ghost he gives up before he dies, doing so by checking in the reflected glass his predeceased soul. And maybe all of this is what Whitman means in that phrase, vigil, strange. He too, like the inventions kept at the soldiers' sides, he too was perhaps the mirror in whose eyes many soldiers saw a last image of themselves, already escaped and glowing in the twinkle of this affectionate man's inventive eye. He too was the body into which dying breath was blown so that it might maybe live there, escaped and safe now in this other man and outside the body so doomed. He too, Whitman, maybe, like the glass cases, was the reflector of ghostly remainders, supernatural echoes, peculiar, faint, languishing shades, and not just ongoing life. And in wondering about all this, Whitman was not the only one during those years. Gardner, Brooks, and Lincoln suggest that, but so do at least two other figures, visual artists, both from the early 1860s. Neither was known to Whitman or to one another. Their aims and aesthetics likewise were very different, both from Whitman's and from one another's. Yet somehow, I think you'll see, they're both really quite Whitman-like. And if I could have the first slide, Ramon. And can I have the first slide, Ramon? So one is Charles Christian Nall, right there in San Francisco, who in the year 1863, during the war, with his brother Arthur, published a striking manual called Instructions in Gymnastics. And that's plate 18 from the book that you're looking at. The Nall brothers, recent emigres from Germany, had their own agendas, no doubt. To say that they advocated gymnastics is only part of the story. In this plate, and still more in others depicting human pyramids and other elaborate team formations, they asserted an almost insuperably difficult ethos of masculine self-control, part of San Francisco's middle class, part indeed of the city's vigilante committee. They espoused an order of manly bodily regulation, of exquisite strength and determined practice. That's really more about the lawless streets of San Francisco than the balance beam. Where Whitman slouched, the Nall brothers tensed every muscle in athletic caricatures of the middle class sobriety, health, and self-control that the poets scorned even in their less athletic manifestations. Yet there is something Whitman-like about the image you're looking at all the same. Not only the young man or men with their handsome physiques, but the ghostly echoes and anticipations of their former and future movements. These evoke the penumbras that flutter around Whitman's subjects. The Nalls shared studio space in downtown San Francisco in the same building on Montgomery Street as the famous photographer Edward Muybridge, and maybe, just maybe, Instructions in Gymnastics, the manual, is an overlooked anticipation of Muybridge's justly famous motion photography of the 70s and 80s. Muybridge's pictures with men and women and animals trailing ghostly images of themselves are maybe themselves visual equivalents of Whitman's excess, where no body is quite itself, quite singular in contour, lest it turn too sculptural. So the same could be said of Nall's young athletes, however much they aspire to a sculptural or chiseled physique, for so they emit these secondary images of themselves at each turn. And so still more Whitman-like, even all the way out in San Francisco, the gymnasts seem a muscular recompense for all the shattered bodies back in the eastern part of the Union, as if the chaos the Nalls would police was not just the drunken, murderous rowdiness of San Francisco, but the deathly destruction of Shiloh and Antietam. The ghostly dotted line extra bodies, just like the extra selves in Whitman, are neither gladly redundant tokens of excessive life, nor ghosts, but some undecided combination of the two. And if I could have the next slide, please. And from that moment, that interest in the fluttering excess, the kind of living excess of the frozen instant, to another, though very different, a striving to show that same kind of fluid moment. On the screen is a painting called Rio de Janeiro Bay by the American artist Martin Johnson Heed. A painting from early 1864. One of the pictures Heed made on a trip to South America that began in the previous year. And again, as you look at this picture, you can see that the differences from Whitman are clear. Heed went to Brazil, partly to escape the war Whitman was so much in the thick of. Heed's scene of a placid, beautiful bay is the opposite of Whitman's gore of chopped limbs and smoking wounds. Yet let's look at it a little bit more. Heed, I feel, is the poet of the breaking wave. He made so many pictures, mainly in North America, of these waves. The wave, as here, is the sign for Heed of the moment. He's involved, as any painter of a wave would have to be, with trying to render the instant, trying more than that to show that the instant is by its very nature ragged at the edges, churning and dissolving even as it coheres. For all its difference from Nall's gymnastic figures, Heed's wave is another dotted line, another form swiveling through time. And more than that, this wave suggests itself to me, as I've looked at it at the National Gallery in Washington, as the motif, the metaphor for all instants, as Whitman, Nall, and others tried to understand them at a time of death, for the way every moment, every experience is in effect a wave that crashes raggedly over and past us in a whelming and sensuous way. For the way, too, that these momentary experiences, for all their physical immediacy, yet contain within themselves, down in their curtained hollows, their gathered recesses, depths of mystery, of far-reaching significance, the extensiveness of the heavens, the waves echoing the kind of wave of the clouds on the horizon, that make it wrong to say that such a moment, such a wave breaking, is only a physical, just a physical sensation. Whitman's poetry of the war in this same way registers the delicate sensations and reverberations that play and resound amid the scripted frozen scenes of persons and things. The poetry turns muscle and bone, stone and steel, to a kind of wash of breaking sensation, so that the ocean, as Whitman himself said, is the metaphor for his verse. The liquid billowing waves, ever rising and falling, always moving, he says, never finished or fixed, always suggesting something beyond. And if I could have the next slide, please. And maybe that's why, last, as a historian, I'm drawn to things in Washington, current day Washington, that harken back to Whitman's way of experiencing that city. And you know, really, I'm drawn mainly to one thing. It's the large lamppost outside Ford's Theater on 10th Street, which you see here. It's nowadays a modern reproduction of the extra large gas lamps that were placed outside theaters in the 19th century. The Ford's original was ripped out and melted down for scrap metal during World War II. But a photograph from 1868 of the other prestige theater in Washington at that time shows a nearly identical large lamp outside the front entrance. So the current lamp, which runs on gas, is therefore pretty authentic. So why am I drawn to it? Why have I spent, I don't know, on a beautiful, mild, moonlit October night in Washington upwards of 45 minutes at a stretch, contentedly staring at it? And why has this staring, all unbidden and accidental, been one of the most intense aesthetic experiences of my life? Well, the gas lamp is a kind of eternal flame for Lincoln, I get that. I also understand that Whitman liked gas lamps. He read the news of Fort Sumter beneath one of them in New York. He walked alongside a soldier in Washington, catching glimpses of the man's face by the lamps we passed, he says. And as we know, the White House itself that February evening glowed amid the brilliant and extra plentiful clusters of gas. I know even that Whitman wrote of the infuriated crowd on the night of Lincoln's death, his assassination, preparing to hang an innocent man from the lamppost outside Ford's Theater, maybe the very lamppost on the spot where this modern replacement now stands. But none of that quite gets it for me. It's not as a sign of what Whitman saw or heard, so much as a sign of the way he saw everything in Washington during the war, that the gas lamp is meaningful to me now. The flames, they're redoubling on the reflective glass of the lamp case, I experience as a sign, stronger than I've ever felt before, of the experience of the past, of the way the past asserts itself for you or for me, not just as facts, figures, and events, but as a flickering sensuousness, a sign then, this lamppost for me, of the way each historical figure, each event stands forth, if we can discern them now, not in stone, not in cold and bloodless electrotype, and not even exactly in life, if by that we mean a biographical and normative sense of what a person or situation must have really been like, but rather as a flame, every event, everything, every person a flame, a city of these flames, so that there would never be for the historian, as there would never be for Whitman, a scene so vivid, so sharp, and durable that it did not also gently, strangely burn. Thank you.
January 2000. I had just graduated from Marine Corps boot camp, Paris Island, South Carolina. It was family day, and I had a little bit of free time, and I took that free time, and I walked straight up to my senior drill instructor, snapped to attention, and said, "Senior drill instructor, would you like to speak to you, sir?" He was a short man. He had like these really, really evil eyes and braces. He looked down at me and he said, "What?" "Just really like to show you something, sir." And I handed him a yellow manila envelope full of photos. One of them was an 8x10 photograph of me in a tunic and white tights, holding a ballerina with a tutu in Sleeping Beauty, a ballet. He pulled that photo out of the manila folder, shook his head, and said, "Oh, Baca. Baca, I knew there was something weird about you." I was a classical ballet dancer before I joined the Marine Corps. As you read in the program, I served in Fallujah, Iraq from 05 to 06. We were deployed as a combat element. I transitioned, us as a unit transitioned from doing combat patrols after 3 months to doing humanitarian patrols. We saw a need in the community in Iraq. We started that by going into the local school and handing out school supplies and notebooks and pens and pencils for the students. I was so lucky to go to Iraq with so many Marines that wanted to make a difference in a community, and in a community so far away. When I got back in 06, I started to do things that I thought people did when they came back from war. I got a good job, I bought a house, I settled down with my girlfriend. And a little bit later, she sat me down and she said, "You're not okay. You're not the guy I knew before the war. You're angry, you're anxious, you're depressed. You're making people afraid of you." But she wanted to help me, so she said, "If you could do anything in the world, what would you do?" I told her I'd start a dance company. And she's a ballerina, and she said, "Let's do it." So in 2007, we started Exit 12 Dance Company. What you're going to see tonight is pieces of how Exit 12 started, but then you're going to see more. You're going to see layers upon layers of stories that tell about human experience, that tell about people who've been through conflict and walked on the other side. So many people have contributed to these stories. Actually, we were at the VA, just like they were telling you about earlier, and there was a veteran there who asked us why we only wear Marine camis. The reason that everyone in the audience is thinking is because, well, you know, the Marines are the best service branch. I'm kidding, that's a joke. No, it's, I know. I bet you other service branches are going, "You're not smart enough to tell that joke, Jarhead." The veteran came up to us and she said, and I told her the reason why is because, you know, arts funding is really sparse and we try to run as low speed and low cost as possible, and so we use donated uniforms. And she donated her uniforms, and actually we used them for that first piece. So no further ado, we're going to go along in the program, and I'll tell you a little bit more about the program later, but please enjoy. Thank you. That piece was called Sometimes Silence by Angela Simonelli. What's interesting about Exit 12 is when we started telling these stories of veterans and the military experience, other choreographers started coming to us saying that they had things that they wanted to say. Angela was one of them. Her two sons, Jake and Sam, were in the Army and were getting deployed to Afghanistan. And so she wanted to tell that story from a mother's perspective. What's beautiful is that her brother, Paul Simonelli, was a Marine too, and he served in the Marine Band. He was one of the president's own. And so when she told him about the ballet that she wanted to choreograph, he composed the music. And he got a bunch of his buddies together. They went into a recording studio and they recorded that music you heard played alongside the piece. I get to tell you the happy ending. Jake and Sam are fine. They got home from their deployments in Afghanistan and they're continuing to serve their country. And you find that with a lot of service members and a lot of veterans is that they continue to serve their country. We have other choreographers that have entrusted us with so much. The next piece you're going to see is a look at a son's worry about his family in Egypt during the Arab Spring uprising and his perspective on that. And then one of the very dear pieces you're going to see later on in the program is set to poetry by one of my very dear friends, William Michael Day. William was a Marine. He served in 03 in the surge in Iraq. He saw some of the heaviest fighting in Al-Nasiri and Al-Qut. And he wanted to serve when he got back because he wasn't dealing with civilian life okay. So he became a social worker and went to the Manhattan VA where he was helping veterans day in and day out, and it wasn't doing much to help Michael. So Michael turned to poetry. And then he entrusted us with two of his poems, which we turned into dances. I think the most beautiful thing about this evening and about Exit 12 is the trust and the honesty with which we approach these subjects. So without further ado, enjoy the rest of the program. Thank you.
Thank you. dilemma. I have grown weary of your thoughts, these stories, these anecdotes, these euphemisms and hypothetical scenarios. Let me entertain them alone. Allow me to briefly detach myself from this environment. I want to own this space, so give me a moment to move with my burdens in solitude. They can only be carried by me. They tell me I belong to the collective. My unit, my brothers, my sisters, my Marine Corps. They tell me I cannot be separated from this bond that we share. But in this space, even if only for a brief period of time, this moment belongs to me. If you want me to be a part of this, then let me stand briefly apart. This war belongs to all of us, but this gear on my back and shoulders causes me pain that only my muscles know. My brothers and sisters suffer similar pain, but empathy has its boundaries. The psychological and physiological tolls that I must endure belong to me. Long when this war has ended, and my pack is stored in a garage with other memories, I will sit in the room with my thoughts and my pain. You will not be there to catch the tears falling from my cheeks. Somewhere closer distant, tears will fall from one of your cheeks and I will be gone. When I return home, I will walk blocks unknown and known alike on my own. When I sit on my porch, looking at the horizon and attempting to understand my place without war, you will be a world away. When I hold my lover's hand as she searches for explanations why I can no longer be the person that left her, you will be battling your own numbness. For you see, bullets have a powerful way of bringing us together, but the greater power lies in a bullet's ability to pull us apart. I move forward in this space, consumed. I hope you understand. I'm afraid I'm going to die alone. Who is going to want to be with me inside of my messed up head and dealing with the horrible things that I think about myself and the world? I can't stop crying and I don't know what will make it better. I'm really scared that I'm going to die alone. I don't want money. I don't want fame. I don't want a nice car or a house. I just don't want to die alone. I can't even type right now. I'm crying so hard and I thought, oh well, just let it flow and see what comes of it. I'm not so sure this was such a good idea. It hurts so bad, snot dripping from my face and my eyes flooded with tears. And I don't care, and I'm just drooling and crying and wondering if it will end. And if it does end, who will it end with? They say write about what you know, and I don't feel like I know anything anymore. So how can I write? I'm scared I will die alone in this dumb apartment in a place where no one ever comes. And I feel like I don't have much left in me, like there is nothing left inside. I feel dead already and numb. And who would want me like this? And who would like me like this? And who would need me like this? And I want to wake up and everything is fine, but everything is not fine. And I can't sleep because of bills. And I have to work because of bills. So I will get up and just go to work and pretend it is okay. But it's not okay and I need help. And I want to check in somewhere that can help me. But the bills, where will I live? I have a lease. I hate the way we live. I hate the way I live. I can't figure anything out. Why is everything so foreign to me? I know what's going on, but I have no clue. And this is a horrible feeling to have deep inside of you that only comes out when someone provokes you or you've had one too many. Or you see the same look of pain in a friend's eyes and know exactly what they are going through. But you can't do a goddamn thing because you can't even help yourself. And when the hugs don't work anymore, what is left? What is left? What is left?
Okay. So where do we go from here? We are at this place where, what happens next? I think Michael is the perfect example. So you just heard Michael's poetry. You just saw two of the works that we did about his work. Michael continues to serve, and that's how he's found that place of healing. He started serving by writing poetry, and then he went and started teaching other veterans how to write poetry. And that transitioned him into a job where all he does now is tell stories about things that are going on in the world with Vice TV. I had a similar opportunity, just like Michael. I wanted a way to continue to serve. I mean, Exit 12 is one way. But in 2012, I had the opportunity to serve not only my country, but the world. I had an opportunity to go back to Iraq, this time not as a Marine, but this time as a civilian artist. And through a fellowship with an organization called The Mission Continues, I worked with Battery Dance Company out of New York City, who's doing wonderful things overseas, bringing divergent communities together through dance. And with another dancer named Robin Cantrell, we went to Erbil, Iraq, and we worked with 15 kids from Erbil and 15 kids from Kirkuk. Half of them were Kurdish, half of them were Arabic. And we brought them together and we created this dance piece. And they wanted this dance piece to be about what they thought about America, what they thought America thought about them, how it felt for those young people to live through war their whole life, and the simple fact that they just wanted to go to school and to raise a family in a safe place. Isn't that what we all want? So I can stand up here and I can tell you about that experience, or I can have my dancers show you the work that was choreographed by those 30 young people, Robin Cantrell and myself. Enjoy. Thank you all. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So now is the portion of the program where I don't know what happens. We're doing a Q&A. So I hope you'll stay around and talk about this work for a bit and talk about some matters that are really, really important. I'm going to turn it over to you, shall I? And again, I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart on behalf of Exit 12. Thank you so much for coming tonight.
Can we get two chairs for you?
Yep, done.
Thank you. So Professor Nemerov is going to come up as well and have a seat on stage. And if you guys want to sit on stage or if you want to, whatever's most comfortable for you. And we have a microphone here at the front for anybody who'd like to come up and ask questions of Roman or Alex or any of the dancers.
Hello again. My name is Karen. For those of you who didn't meet me at Livermore in Menlo, I'm one of the psychiatric nurses there and the owner of that uniform. I'm going to ask the same question I asked you all at Livermore, where they performed for my veterans who have dementia. When you're interpreting these pieces based on the poetry and the writings that you've received, could you share with us what goes through your heart and through your mind and through your body as you're taking someone's words like that, you know, of such violence and of such experience and interpreting it to the dance?
I'll start. I'm loud. Hi, my name is Taylor Gordon. I've danced with Exit 12 for 5 years now. My brother is actually in the U.S. Army deployed in Afghanistan right now on his second tour. Yes, thank you for him. So when I dance this work, as opposed to classical ballet work or any other form of dance, it's extremely personal for me. I feel like I'm channeling my brother's stories and attaching them to the stories that we've worked with, that we've heard. And every time I perform, I feel it deep. Every time I watch, sometimes Silence, I didn't dance tonight, but when I watch that, I get tears in my eye every time because I actually experienced that hug goodbye. So it's very, very moving for me, and I'm so thankful to be a part of this and to be able to spread what we do and to be here in California with you all.
So. I think for a lot of people, war affects, you know, either their parents or their grandparents. My family has certainly been affected by war, the Vietnam War, and my parents came over to the U.S. as refugees. And so I kind of try to channel that the same way that Taylor does for her brother and her family. I kind of think of my own history with war, even though I'm not directly affected by that. And I bring that into the works when we work with veterans and when we're creating new work and just rehearsing, trying to channel you know, the experiences and the narratives that I've heard. I think that it's a beautiful thing what we do together. And you know, when we have so many narratives, we become a very collective voice. And in that, there's a lot of community. And so I think that's a really beautiful thing.
So as Aaron was talking, I smiled. And the reason I smiled is because I think we are putting a lot of trust into these artists. And every time they talk, they surprise me in beautiful ways. I had no idea Aaron's story. And it just warms my heart to know that these artists are willing to work with this material in such an honest and trustworthy way. So I'm going to help it. I'm going to answer a couple of the frequently asked questions that most people ask. Yes, that's my wife with the red hair. Exit 12 is not a military term. It is the exit off of the FDR in New York City where we started. That's where the name came from. And No, I didn't tell a lot of people in the military that I was a ballet dancer until I tried in boot camp, but it wasn't met with a very warm reception. So then I took it right back out of the air and put it down deep. And I didn't talk about it again until Fallujah, when we got bored. When we weren't running combat patrols, we were standing post. And if the veterans in any veteran can attest to standing post. I started talking about it to my best friend and my roommate, and I told him about this dance that I wanted to create when I got back home. And he came back to post the next night with a piece of paper and said, let's write it down and let's do this. And Joe D'Amico performed in like 8 of our first performances as a Marine. So, yeah. Okay, I got the easy questions, harder questions.
Thank you so much, everyone, for just an amazing evening. I am truly humbled and awed by your talents. I have a question for Professor Nemerov. I was just wondering if you would be able to reflect on the changes and also perhaps echoes and similarities between the poetry that we heard of Walt Whitman from the Civil War and the poetry that we heard written about the recent conflicts.
Yes, well, I think the personal is a good word. The vulnerable, the bravery of being fragile is something that Whitman can gloriously teach us, and I think that resonates with what we've seen tonight. Perhaps also that, I don't know, many utterances worth making or stating or performing come from some fathomless personal place that one oneself doesn't know exists until it finds the light of day in a work of art. And then even the maker of that work, whether it's a poem or a dance, is powerless really to explain or account for what they've just done or what they've just felt. All we know is that the world is not the same as it was a moment earlier for them or for anyone who witnesses or reads what's just happened.
Hi, I really enjoyed your performance. Thank you so much for bringing this to Stanford. And my question is about the performance, the piece with the women in the black dresses. And I'm curious to just hear a little bit more about that and the inspiration behind it. And I guess also maybe the metaphors or symbolism behind the black dresses and what they mean. And yeah, it was just really thought-provoking.
Don't leave, stay right there. So the black dresses are abayas. They're the traditional Iraqi clothing that the women wear. Not all women. Now, I'm not going to blanket the country. They wear the traditional Western clothing all the way up to the abayas and even further. What did you take from that?
I mean, so for me, I think, you know, it's the incorporation of the other half into a performance. And like, I mean, I don't come from a military background. In fact, I come from an Iraqi background. And like, I just don't really understand how the two narratives, or maybe I'd like to hear more about how the two narratives are intertwined in this particular conflict, because it's very different than, I don't know, than a typical war narrative, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah. That piece particularly, when we were operating in Iraq, it was very hard to operate because we were given rules of engagement and we would have to follow those rules to the T. However, not every situation we got into was covered by those rules. And so, you know, every day was balancing being a Marine and following rules and being a human being and having empathy and sympathy and concern for fellow human beings. And so when we when I looked at that, I wanted to make a statement about it, a statement about the rules of engagement, the statement about running, stopping a car and having in it a young man who's maybe 15, and then a young woman next to him with a baby in her arms, and she was maybe, you know, 14, 15 years old. And the rules of engagement said to stop that car, order everybody out of the car, search everybody, search the car. And the minute you walk up on that car and you're covered in camouflage and flak jackets and ammunition and weapons, and that young woman looks at you with the fear in her eyes, that's the conflict. And, you know, it wasn't easy. So that's what it was about. What do you think?
I think that's a really good point, and I don't know, thank you for sharing that. I mean, I guess to further the discussion, I think would be an interesting contrast between that performance and then the one of the Iraqi students that we saw at the very end, and I guess their own interpretation of, and it's not necessarily the same types of events, but their own interpretation of how the war has been a conflict for them. I think, I don't know, that's...
I love that perspective because you're exactly right. The peace we created in Iraq totally changed my perspective of the Iraqi people in every single way.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. It was remarkable in every way, and I'm sure everybody here feels as moved as I do. I'm wanting to ask a technical question about your choices between narrative pieces and then others which were more abstract, such as the one that had the very dissonant music in it. So I wonder if you just would comment upon that, upon the need for a narrative, and yet at times it's clear that the narrative is not really necessary, or at least there are other ways of expressing the emotions that you want to convey, which are not narrative. So if you'd just say a few words about that.
Yeah, so dealing with this subject, it's been really interesting trying to find exactly that. Do we want to push a narrative? And I think definitely the Michael Day pieces with the poetry, it's hard not to say we're not pushing a narrative with those pieces because they're narrated. And we're definitely trying to expose the human experience behind the veteran, the way what the veteran experiences. I think all the rest of it, we're trying to really pull back and let the audience find the narrative within it. I definitely think that certainly it was designed with a narrative. And in the first couple of shows, we would tell people, this piece is about this, this piece is about that. But that's not where the power lies. The power lies in letting every individual find a piece of the work that speaks to them. Because that's where you find your grandfather, your grandmother, your mom, somebody important to you. And so that's why we arrange it the way we do. Did that answer your question? I hope. Okay.
My name's Rob Lansfield, and I'm so old you can tell that I'm a lot older than all of you guys. Point is that, and I was an Army brat. Dad went to West Point, and I was never in combat. But first of all, yeah, you did accomplish the mission. I found tears streaming down my face when you showed the separation of the mother and the kids and the father. And thinking of Professor Nemerov, I was reminded that I have some of my ancestors were Volga Germans, and I've been over there, and the Germans and the ethnic Russians and the Jews and everybody, man, they've been killing each other for centuries. But it's got to end. I've been over there. So what's an easy way, like a 25-word elevator pitch, to tell somebody about how they can get better here? You know, like, I find a lot of people don't want to talk about this stuff, either Iraq or Afghanistan. And who cares about Russia? But me.
I'm so glad you asked. We were talking about this today. There is a significant difference between the veteran experience today and your father's experience, my grandfather's experience. One of the things that I found when I started researching this subject matter, because I didn't just want to take the Iraq and Afghanistan perspective from these pieces, I interviewed Vietnam veterans. I talked to my grandfather, who was a Korean War veteran, a couple of World War II veterans that I bumped into at a veterans hospital. And, you know, they didn't want to talk about it to their families. And yet we find that the veterans from today are opening up just a little bit more. And I think it's important, and I think it's important because what's happening is they're remembering why they joined the service. And I use the word service on purpose, because a lot of the veterans that are coming back, and the best way that they're getting better is they're turning back to service to help them. They're getting out of themselves and they're helping other people. And I think that just looking back at the Holocaust, the German experience, and Viktor Frankl, you know, looking beyond yourself and trying to help other people, I think that's where a lot of veterans today are finding the healing in serving others. So there's a lot of organizations out there that, if you know a veteran who needs help, please point them in this direction. Number one is a veteran crisis line. It's the suicide hotline. If you know a veteran in peril, please turn them to the crisis line. It's totally anonymous, and they will help. Iraq and Afghanistan Veterans of America is really helping push veterans' agenda to the top of at least the agenda in Congress and pushing advocacy. The Mission Continues can help turn veterans back into service by putting them to work at nonprofits and back to work in their communities here so they can serve here at home. And there's tons more that are doing some really, really great work out there.
Can I add to that?
Please do.
I will give you my card. If you know anybody or you are somebody who needs help, I will give you my card right now. And I expect to hear from you. And we will get you set up.
Well, thank you very, very much, and thank you for coming. It was such an inspirational night for us. Thank you for hosting us. Thank you, Jacqueline and Audrey, for having us, and Stanford for everything they've done. So a big round of applause for everyone that was involved in putting this together.
Thank you all very much for coming, and I hope you continue to attend Stanford events. And if you would like to be added to our mailing list, I'm going to send out an email letting you volunteer for that. Thank you all, and have a great night. Thank you.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.